can't, they just struggling along, just trying to keep, make it through life. All of them claim to be top-notch Christians. But what a testimony to leave to people, to young people, especially to me. I thought, if this is all this thing about, I'm getting out of it. If I can't live better than that. But anyway, that's the way people live. See, Christ gives us strength. He gives us boldness. That's what the church needs today. We need some strength. Right? True. So let's look at something this morning called reason to draw near to God. This is something we can do. This is something we can do. Because Psalm 73:28. But if it be good for me to draw near to God, I have put my trust in the Lord, that I may declare all thy works. He said, it is good for me to draw near to God. David is saying there that he said, I can do it. I can draw near to God. He said to him, when I do that, I'm going to see all his good works. Isn't that wonderful to know? The Church of God believes in being justified by faith. Certainly believes that. It believes by faith, through faith, and by repentance of all sins. That's what we believe. I mean, that's what God came for. He came to save sinners. To get rid of sin out of people's life. We believe in being regenerated. True? We believe in being sanctified. Right? Presenting our bodies as a living sacrifice unto God, which is a reasonable service. That's what sanctification is all about. Is to present your bodies to God as a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God or unto the Lord, which is your reasonable service. That's what the Bible says. And we can do that. Notice. If I didn't believe God could equip me for victory, I'd get out. I'd just quit. I mean, if I can't have victory, then I need to go someplace else. I mean, if I'm going to serve, I mean, if I'm going to have a defeated life all my life, what good would it do me? See, I need victory. We all need victory. That song, we sing that old song, didn't we? Victory, victory. Wasn't that what the church sang? Okay, to maintain our victory, we must draw near to God. And that's to live close to God. True? I'm going to give us some reasons why we ought to do that this morning. Okay, the struggle starts when we maintain living close to God. That's when you start struggling in life. I don't care what kind of condition we're in. Because the psalmist said, it's good for me. And I believe it's good for all of us. I believe it's good for the church to draw near to God. And there are some reasons that we don't. Reason number one, it will increase our soul burden. We've about lost soul burden anymore, folks. Old times used to talk about how they used to get out and pray before camp meeting and pray before revivals. I remember one time, Brother John and I went over to Bradburn Chapel. They was having a minister's meeting over there, and Brother John suggested that we go back to prayer before camp meeting. And they just over-talked him. I mean, he said, you know, one time we had a lot of power in prayer, and we always prayed before we had a prayer meeting, or a camp meeting, or prayer meeting, or anything like that. And they just said, well, nobody shows up. Nobody show up for him. Defeated before he ever did. And Brother John told me, he said, that's the last time I'm going back. He said, if they don't believe in prayer, he said, I'm not going to mess with them. That's about the way I feel, you know, if you don't believe in there. Brother Osteen used to sing a song. The title of that song was, Lord, wash my eyes with tears that I may see. And that's so true. If we have tears in our eyes for the lost, then we'll start seeing. If we start weeping for the lost, then we'll start seeing. Hardly anybody weeps anymore or prays for the lost. Prayer is disappearing, folks. It's gone, just about it. It's something that we hardly ever see anymore. And if it does, it's not long. I mean, what I'm saying is, a lot of places don't even have prayer hardly. And I guarantee you, a lot of folks that claim to be Christ-like don't have prayer in their home. raised on prayer. When I was a kid, when my dad died, I stayed with my grandfather. He prayed three times a day. You got out on your knees. You didn't sit anywhere. You got out on in front of the old fireplace there, and we had prayer. He had prayer with everybody, and he prayed at the table three times a day. True? You know, there used to be a song we used to sing, "Draw me near, near, blessed Lord. Draw me near." You know the song. I think the writer of that had a point. I think we draw ourselves to God. We got to go draw ourselves to God. But he had a point about we need to see the need to be near God. Isn't that our need this morning in life? That we all and everybody that claims to be a Christian, we need to be closer to God. And when we fail to be close to God, we're going to get in trouble. And Brother Morgan Davis told this, and it stuck with me the day he said it over there at camp meeting. He was preaching over at camp meeting. He talked about this couple, and I've told it here before. He talked about this couple driving down the road. Man's steering the car. He's on the steering wheel. The woman's sitting about to fall out the door on the other side. And here comes a car around him. Cuts back in front of him. There's two people in it, but they look like one. The woman's sitting over next to the man. And she looked at her husband and said, "You know, one time we were just like that." And he said, "I'm going to tell you something." He said, "I haven't moved." He said, "You're the one that scooted over next to the door." That's a good example of being close to God, isn't it? We've moved. See, we've moved over to where we almost fall out the door. God's the driver of this thing, and here we are to be sitting over there with him, like that couple that went around them, went around the couple there. And she said, "Oh, I wish we could just live like that again." He said, "All you got to do is move over next to me." And that's what God said. Isn't that true? And that's always stuck with me, what Brother Morgan Davis said over there at camp meeting. Husband said, "Yep, move on over here." That's what God's saying. Move on up here. Get up here close to me. And that's needed. Isaiah 66 and 8. He said, "Who hath heard such a thing? Who hath seen such a thing? Shall the earth be made to bring forth in one day, or shall a nation be born at once? And as soon as Zion travail," now notice what it says here. "As soon as Zion," that's a church, travail. And you know, we all know what travail is. "She brought forth her children." Now, how are you going to bring forth children? You've got to travail. And what is travail? And this is referring to on the day of Pentecost, when the church was born on the day of Pentecost. That's what it's referring to. But what is that? That is Zion became a nation. We became a nation. Notice 1 Peter 1, it says, "But you're a chosen generation, royal priesthood, a holy nation." So when Zion travails, or toils, or labors, it will bring forth children. That's just like a woman being in labor. You got to, there's pain to that. To have a child, there's pain in it. I don't know anything about it. You ladies could tell us probably all about it. And you probably couldn't tell it. It's probably a pain that you couldn't describe. But when you travail in pain, then you'll bring forth a child. And until the church gets in pain, folks, or toils in pain, we'll never produce a soul. That's what the Bible says. We'll never produce a soul until we travail in pain. And that's what travail means. We can do it. You'll see something happen. And you'll see folks say, when we become like start getting out and having labor, we'll just call it labor pains for the lost, then we'll see people say, that's the only way. I'm talking about real salvation. I'm not talking about somebody just gonna join the church. When we get a real burden, you're gonna see the church increase. That's what it says. It becomes a nation. That's reason one. Reason two, It'll enable us to play to fill our place in the church more effectively. See, if we draw them out of God, we'll fulfill our church and our place in the church more effectively. And we've all got a place. This is a body. And that's what the, you know, when we speak the truth in love. Now notice in Ephesians 4:15-16. He said, speaking the truth in love, we will grow up unto him in all things which is ahead, which him the whole body filleth joined together and compact. Every joint supplies, working in the measure, every part, making increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love. See what he's saying? He's saying when we get close to God, we'll start producing. This will become a body. We'll become a body. The body that Jesus Christ built, or not built, but what Jesus has raised up and put us in. That's the body of us. And this body will grow when we start producing and we start having pain or having desire for people that's lost. Like I said, the old timers used to do that. They'd go out in the thickets. I know Brother Osteen said that when they went down the pass, they went up in the woods and prayed before each service. And the way they did it back in, all the preachers got together. They'd put you out if you didn't get with them, go up and pray. And they'd pray for whoever's got the message that night. And he said, if you said you got the message, said they'd pray, one of these preachers got the message. And they didn't appoint people to preach. They just said, who's got the message? Said, if you raised your hand, you better have it, or said they'd call you down. So they could tell when you got in the pulpit if you was preaching truth of what it was, that they'd get up and say, son, you need to sit down. Somebody else get up here and finish the sermon. He said, I've seen it done several times. But he said the church had power in those days because they trusted God for everything. They drew near to God. And in prayer is the way that we draw near to God. Every member of the body has its place to fulfill. See, we here this morning have a place in the body. You have a place. I have a place. We all have a place. And we got to fill that place to make the body function right. Just like we talked about this other Sunday. Just like our natural body here. This hand's got to fill its place for this natural body to work right. So that's the same way Jesus compared to the church. Right? That's what, when you look at your body, you're looking at the church. Because of its unity and the way it works. So the man of God, and like over in Kings 19:11-12, we all have read this. God sent his man upon the mountain. And he said, go stand on the mountain. He said, you can hear my voice. I'll be up there. You hear my voice. So what did he do? He sent a strong wind. The wind came and broke the rocks on the mountain. Did everything, a lot of damage upon the mountain. And the prophet said, oh, God's bound to be in this. He's going to talk to me out of the storm. Well, he didn't talk out of the storm. See, sometimes we think he's got to talk to us out of a storm and fly. It don't happen that way. Then God sent an earthquake and a fire. He sent an earthquake and rocks started tumbling. The mountain was about to fall down. Old prophet said, I'll guarantee you the Lord's in this. But he wasn't in there. Guess what he was in? He was in a still, small voice. God spoke to him in a still, small voice. Now, what's that saying to him? That's saying that sometimes you've got to slow down, be quiet, and just take it easy and let God talk to you. That's what it said. It's not in the big shouts, folks. It's not in the big commotions. Although we can get tied up in it. It's enjoyable to get in a service where everybody gets happy. We could take some lessons from the charismatic people, I guess. Because they have big commotions in their service. We could probably do that. But you got to remember, God's not in that all the time. He's in a still, small voice. And that's the way we hear God. Right? It's through his still, small voice. is still that still small voice that we need today. And the only way that we're going to hear is to get near to God. That's where the voice comes from. Reason number four. It'll empower us to see how to walk straight. Now here's an interesting point. It will empower us how to know how to walk straight. You know, the closer you get to God, the straighter you're going to get. Right? Because I'm sure that if you're not walking straight, you don't want to meet Him. But anyway, so we'll see how to walk straight. We need to hear God's voice through His Word. See, we need a clear spiritual truth of the Word of God. Right? That's what's going to help us. That's what's going to help us throughout life, isn't it? It's that clear spiritual truth. The Bible says, "Where there's no vision, people perish." If I don't have a vision, you don't have a vision, folks. People are going to die around us. True? If I can't come up with a good vision for God and see the need of going out and visiting people, asking those people to come to meeting, people are going to die. They perish. And without a clear vision, folks, they'll perish. So we've got to get our vision on God. There's a wonderful song I love. Brother Doyle sings it. And Brother Whitehead wrote it. Don't lose your vision of the church. Brother Doyle ever comes in, he'll say, "I got to sing Brother Bill's song." Don't lose your vision of the church. And that's what people are losing. They're losing their vision of the church. Notice what he said. The church which on Mount Zion stands. There's some of the words to it. It's the only one of its mother. There just isn't any other. Come and walk in the light, my brother. And that is so true. See, we've got to where we've lost our vision of the church of God and what Jesus built. And when we see the church of God, we'll walk in the light, my brother. And Brother Doyle will sing it every time. There just isn't any other. And nothing else besides what Jesus built. I wouldn't have anything except Jesus built. And you wouldn't either. You shouldn't. True? See? Get near to God. And we'll get a vision of God's church. That's the only vision He's going to give us is a vision of His. True? The one Jesus built, not man. The Bible says He placed the members in the body as it pleases Him. True? And if you go over to Acts 2, the Lord added to the church daily those that should be saved. Who added to the church? God added to the church daily those that should be saved. Away with this opening up church doors and taking in people. Folks, God adds you to the church. And when you get close to Jesus, you'll see that. True? Reason number four, it'll empower us to see how to walk straight. That's what we need today. We need empowerment how to walk straight. True? Give you a little example here in a minute. The modern day teaching is what? Join some church, walk the way I want to walk, do what I want to do, dress the way I want to dress, act the way I want to act, think the way I want to. Think. It's my way or the highway. True? It's not God's way. It's my way. It's what I want to do. It's me doing my own thing. That's what we call church. If whatever I can do and do my own thing, that's what people call church. See, that's why mega churches survive so much, folks. You know what you can do? You can go to a mega church and get lost in it. Go out and Joel Osteen. Go out there and sit up there and go. You don't have any responsibility whatsoever. You don't know the person, half of them don't know the people they sit next to. They have no fellowship with one another. They go in there and sit down and listen to what he said and get up and leave. Because with no responsibility. True? We try to say that we got responsibility. We got to serve God with responsibility. We got to go out and see people and see their condition. Isn't that true? Psalms 37:23 says, "The steps of the good man are ordered to the Lord." So the good man, how? What is it? God sets his steps in order. That's what we need. Isn't that so true? His order to the Lord. In Psalms 85:13, righteousness shall go before him and shall set him in the way of his steps. In Psalms 119:133, order my steps in the Lord, in the word. 1 Peter 2:24, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving for us an example. Isn't that what he says? An example. Let me read that right. I wrote this scripture down. Example that you should follow in his footsteps. Now here's the example. Done some research on a pigeon one time. I was reading about this. They did some research on a pigeon. You know how a pigeon walks. What he does when he moves, he takes one step. And then he has to think before he takes the other step. When they did this research, they found out why he walks the way he walks. Every time he takes a step, he's got to adjust himself to take another step in his thinking. So he takes him another step. Head back a step, head forward a step. Put that in perspective. When we move for God, how we're supposed to do it. One step at a time. Amen. It's what he does. And then you think. And if we took one step at a time, and then we thought, before we ever moved again, a lot of things we wouldn't get in trouble over. Every time you do something in life, you got to think. And you got to think, what would Jesus do? And what would God hold, what would God have us to do? And that's the problem that we have. We're moving without him. We don't think. But that pigeon has to think before he can ever take another step. And that's the way it should be with us. You know, a lot of times we get ourselves in trouble by taking steps ahead of the Lord. Financial trouble especially. I've done some stupid things in my life, folks, money-wise. And we all have, I guess. And we wasn't thinking. We take a step and never think about God. Never put him in the picture. Then you get home with something and be in debt or whatever it was, make some mistakes and run your mouth before you realize it, and run your mouth and be in trouble. But when we take that step, we got to think before we take the next step. That's what a pigeon does. They did a research on them. And that's what they found out, why that they walk the way they walk. Not only that, but the other animals do the same thing. So if we get to a point in life where we can walk, take one step, put God in control of our life, and take a second step, and put him in control of the next step, then we're going to accomplish a lot for God. Because first of all, most of the time when we take a step, we're taking it for ourselves. But when we put God in the forefront of this thing, before we ever move, then things are going to happen, and happen in our life for the good, and not for the bad, right? So we must remember, one step, think of God. When you start making all these transactions in life, without God, we need to think before we act. That's the main thing, isn't it? And ask God for directions in all our affairs. It don't matter whatever you're going to do. Ask God what he would have us to do. That's not so bad in life. That's not so bad to ask God to say, "Well, I'm going to make a decision. I need you to be involved in this decision." Is that so bad? I think it's pretty good. I think it's nice to have a partner that's going to help you and help you the right way. Because he partners up with us, folks. And that's what this is all about. Reason number five. Nearer to God means we're closer to one another. If you get near to God, you're going to be closer to one another. True? Give you a little example. Let's put four men on that wall and women, and four on that wall, and four on that wall, and four on that wall back there. We're going to put God in the middle and put a table in there and put a candle on the candlestick in there and light that candle. That represents God. They were all going to take steps. And as you take a step, you start closing in on the table, right? These people up here are coming together, these people up here, and the people in the back are coming toward the table, coming toward God. Two things it does. It gets you closer to Jesus Christ, and it gets you closer to one another. Think about it. Because you're closing in, and every time you close in to God, you're getting closer to each other. It works. Four people on each wall. Everybody takes a step toward God. And you're getting closer to God, and you're also getting closer to your brothers and sisters. True? That's the way it works. The closer I get to him, the closer I get to you. Are you to me? And that is what being the church of God and the church of God family is all about. Being close to one another, each other. You get close to God and you'll get close to your fellow man. True? That's why a lot of folks are not close to their fellow man, because they don't get close to God. True? What did Jesus pray in Luke, John 17? Now this is a real Lord's Prayer, what he prayed over there. People talk about the Lord's Prayer. Go over there and listen to what he prayed, or read it. He prayed that we all become one. He prayed that we all become one. True? Wasn't that his prayer? Wasn't that what he prayed for? That his followers would all be one. And by coming to him, we all become one. True? That his family or his church might become one. And that's what we need. You know, man is split and splintered. Run people off, done this, said this, done so many things, put his opinions, his ideas into a batch of religion. Has hurt people so bad that they'll never come back. I hope when my mother died, she was right. Because they wronged her about marriage and remarriage so much when her and my stepfather got married. They didn't believe. I come from a family in Jackson, they don't believe in marriage and remarriage. Yet all their kids were married and remarried. But they're going to hell. But when mother got married, going to hell. Unless you leave Harry and go back and straighten all that mess up. And Harry's he annulled his first marriage because he and his wife didn't live together for no time. And they put her in hell. And that hurt her. It really hurt her. So she didn't know what to do. I didn't know anything about it. I didn't know how to try to explain anything back in those days. But you can get such a grudge in your heart, in your life, and get such a distaste for so-called Christian people that you'll never come to God. It's all because of what people say. And it's hard to get your life straightened out. Once you get in that rut, you can't get it back on track. That's hard to do. You've seen people do that. Like I say, men's put their opinions and doctrines and all this stuff into people's minds and in their life and made a big church movements upon it. And it's damaged people. Right? 27. He said, 7 and 8, submit yourselves to, therefore to God, resist the devil and he'll flee from you. Draw nigh to God and he'll draw nigh to you. What did he say? He said, draw nigh to God and he'll draw nigh to you. Notice what he went on to say, draw nigh to God. Do you clean your hands, you sinners, purify your hearts and double-minded. The nearer you get to God, the less you think of self. You ever thought about that? The nearer you get to God, the less you think of self. People become selfish when they get away from God. Where selfishness comes from? It comes from your own actions, folks. It's where it comes from. And like I said, the closer you get to God, the more you're going to see people and see your brothers and sisters. You forget about self. You get saved and get right with God, you forget about self. Self's not involved in this when you get close to God. You got to remember that God is the potter and we're the clay. He can mold us with his hands. He can do anything in the world with us that he wants. We got to face that. We can rebel against him anytime you want to. You can say no to him. That's easy. He'd tell you to call somebody to go down the road and leave something. He'd say no to that. One little example I forgot to give you. Well, I said this little boy living together in New York. Didn't have clothes. Man, little guy come by, interviewed him one day. Asked him, said, son, do you believe in God? And he said, yeah. He said, well, why don't God send you some clothes and some food? He said, I guess nobody's listening when God speaks. That's so true with a lot of people. If God's told a lot of people to do something, nobody listens when I call your name. That's a sad thing. You know, if you ever had a mate, and something happened to the mate, and you call their name, nobody answers back. That's sad when somebody calls the phone and God don't answer back. Why didn't he answer back? Because he called and told someone to go do that job and nobody listened. See, we can listen or we can turn him down. Right? True? Draw nigh to God. And if we draw nigh to God, we'll have a supreme desire to seek him. That's where it comes from. We'll never do anything without him. Our steps might be small, but he's got some big old steps. You just take one little step toward him and you'll see some big steps that he'll take. True? You prove that in your own life. Our steps might get small, but his is big. I mean, you take that prodigal son that left home. What father was standing waiting on that son? He saw him coming, he ran to the boy. He was taking steps toward home. He ran to him, right? Same thing with God. That's drawn out of God, and he'll run to us. But it's we got to initiate this run. We got to initiate these steps. And once we do it, folks, you're going to see a great difference in your life. You're going to see a great difference in the church when we draw a line to God. Because he won't forsake us. David said, it's good for me to draw a line to God. And folks, I believe we all this morning can say amen to that. I believe we could all stand up and shout together. Like they did when David came back from battle one time and they took up an offering. And everybody shouted. They shouted. Can we get to work when we give money to God that we can shout over that? I don't care how big it is, how little it is. Can we get to work? We can shout and God let us live and let us enjoy life so much and gave us so much. And we'll shout over that. draw nigh to God, and He'll draw nigh to us. Okay, church? Just try it one time. Say, like Brother Osteen was talking about faith, and I said this here before. He told some people that we was going to church there. Or that some people told him this, and lady told him, said, you know, you got this way, take an aspirin. He said, you got to take these steps one time. You got to take steps to God. He said, when you get a headache, don't run, get the aspirin bottle and the Tylenol and all that stuff. Just call upon God. And said, after a while, you'll forget about that headache. And that's the way it is. Call upon God for the little things, you know. Put Him in charge of the little things. And pretty soon, we can do some big things with Him. Because big things are coming. Big things coming. Sister Donald had that in her life. We've all had that in our life. Big things will come. And you better take the little step before they get there to do the big things. Mm-hmm. True? Okay. Hope you said something to help us this morning. Draw nigh to God and He'll draw nigh to you, okay? Thank you for your good attention this morning. Let's go home. You ready? Sister Betty, dismiss us. Yes, Lord.
We pray that you will just lead us and guide us in this day and help us to do the things that you have.
Yes.
Lord, we thank you for Brother Bill's message. We pray that you take us to our homes with us. May we grow in today from the day. Lord, we pray for those who are lost, Lord, and pray that you
bless
their hearts. May they find you before it's too late, Lord. We pray that you be with all the requests of prayer, Lord.
Yes, God.
We pray that you touch each body, Lord, according to thy will.